Hello viewers, today let us discuss about Raman effect. Sir C.V. Raman was a famous Indian scientist. He got his inspiration for this Raman effect during his 15-day voyage in Mediterranean Sea in the year 1921. During his voyage, his mind raised many inquisitive questions. Why the sky is blue? Why the ocean is blue? So he went on reflecting over and got answers for many, many questions. C.V. Raman discovered Raman effect, which is a light scattering effect, in the year 1928. He won Nobel Prize on February 28 in 1930 for this experiment. In 1961, invention of laser made Raman scattering the most remarkable. In 1977, surface-enhanced Raman scattering was discovered. In 1997, surface-enhanced Raman spectroscopy for single molecule became possible. So, in commemoration of this eminent scientist, every 28th February of every year is celebrated as National Science Day in fond remembrance of Sir C.V. Raman. Before studying Raman effect, let us know about Rayleigh scattering. Let us consider a molecule like this. On this molecule, a light photon of energy h nu is impinging on this molecule. The molecule absorbs this energy and goes to excited state, and then it returns to the normal state by giving out the absorbed energy. So there is no change in the energy of the molecule, but some scattering took place. It got into excited and returned to the normal state. Because there is no change in energy, there is no change in the frequency of the spectrum observed due to this scattering. Rayleigh observed that in the spectrum of scattered light, there is change in the intensity of the scattered light, but there is no change in the wavelength or frequency. This scattering is called Rayleigh's scattering. Now let us discuss about Raman effect. When a light photon incident on the molecule or atom of a substance, two types of scatterings are possible. One is Rayleigh scattering, another is Raman scattering. In Rayleigh scattering, there is no change in frequency of the spectral lines in the scattered light. Whereas in Raman scattering, something else is taking place. Let us see what is Raman effect. When light interacts with a molecule, the light incident photon can donate a small amount of energy to the molecule of the substance. As a result, photon loses energy, so it is getting scattered with less energy. So there is change in frequency of the scattered light. The incident light donates little energy to the molecule. As a result, molecule gets excited, and the incident photon getting scattered with lower energy, so its frequency is decreasing. There is another possibilities there. When the light photon striking the atom or the molecule, this molecule could give little energy to the incident photon. As a result, the incident photon gets scattered with more energy. So the spectral light due to this process has more frequency. Thus, during this interaction, the frequency of the incident photon when scattered could increase if it absorbs energy from the molecule, could decrease if it donates energy to the molecule. As a result, the scattered light changes its color. If you study this scattered light and what is the change in its color, on what is the change in its frequency, we will be able to predict many things about the molecule of the substance. The molecule is made up of how many atoms and how the atoms are bonded together in the molecule and how the bonding is present, how these molecules are vibrating. All this could be understood if we are able to study the Raman effect. So Raman effect, in simple terms, we can say it is a light scattering technique in which photons interact with the molecules of the substance to produce scattered radiation of varying wavelength, and it is called Raman effect. If there is no change in wavelength, if there is no change in frequency, then this scattering becomes Rayleigh scattering. When there is change in frequency or wavelength, the same effect becomes Raman effect. Okay, so Raman effect, when it was carried out, they found that vibration and rotation Raman bands are obtained with the liquids and solid substances, and rotational bands are obtained with gases where the gas molecules are free to rotate. So when the scattered light is studied, they absorb some bands. Some bands are vibration bands, some bands are vibrational rotational bands, and some are purely rotational bands. And they distinguish the substance, liquids and solids usually give rise to vibration rotation Raman bands, and the gases would give rise to only pure rotational bands. So the change in frequency depends on the chemical structure of the molecules responsible for scattering. Now this is the spectrum originally obtained by Raman. Line present in the scattered light whose frequency did not change. And this side, these cluster of lines tells that their frequency is more than the frequency of the original line. That means these lines are due to the photon that have absorbed energy from the molecule of the substance. And to the left side, some lines are seen. These lines are due to the photons which have donated energy to the molecules of the substance. As a result, their frequency is reduced. Now let us look at the experimental setup. A transparent tube is taken. In this tube, the substance under study could be taken. The substance could be a solid, a liquid, or gaseous substance. So it has length this much and it has smaller width. And one end of the tube is blackened. And the other end, there is a small hole so that the light scattered by the molecules of the substance could be observed through this hole with the help of a spectrograph. So this tube is called Raman tube. It has length and its width is very small compared to its length of the tube. One side of the tube is coated with black paint so that when the scattered light is viewed, the black background gives a beautiful background so that the spectral lines could be studied very easily. If it is white, the line's presence could not be realized. To make it more clear, a dark background is, a black paint is coated here. And this Raman tube is surrounded by a water jacket through which water flows in and flows out. The reason is the incident light continuously falling on the substance. Maybe the temperature of the substance could change. We want to study the effect of the light that is falling on the substance. Purely due to this light, how the spectral lines are getting modified. If the constant flow of light keeps the substance, the spectrum will not be purely due to the incident light. So to avoid this excess heat, water is circulated so that the substance temperature is maintained at the same level. Sir C.V. Raman chose a lamp source which gives out line spectrum He has chosen a mercury lamp. You know, mercury lamp is a white light source and it contains all the seven colors. Now, if all the seven colors are allowed to fall on the substance, the scattered light will have all the seven colors and studying them will be very difficult. To eliminate this problem, he used a filter. A filter is a thin, transparent film whose color allows only that color of the light to pass through and absorbs all other colors of the incident light. For example, if it is a green filter, it allows the green line of this mercury source to pass through and this filter absorbs all other colors. If it is a red filter, it allows only the red color and all other colors will be absorbed. So a filter is used to choose a particular wavelength which can be allowed to fall on the substance taken in the Raman tube. There is a reflector surrounding this Raman tube. There is a provision in the upper reflector so that light can fall on the substance taken in the Raman tube. This entire setup is kept inside another glass tube where vacuum is enclosed so that the collision of stray light with the substance or the air molecules, everything could be avoided. So the entire setup is set up in another transparent tube where vacuum is enclosed so that the experimental study become very effective. A spectrograph is used. The dark background provided suitable situation. So the light that falls on the substance gets scattered in all directions. The scattered light going this way will be reflected back and all of them will be falling on the molecules of the substance. So some incident photons donate energy to the molecules. Some photons absorb energy from the molecules. All this could take place here. So through a hole, the scattered light is allowed and it can be studied with the help of a spectrograph. When it was studied with the help of a spectrograph, the spectrum obtained was this. This is the original line. The filter chose one particular spectral line and let us say its frequency is nu. In the scattered light, Raman observed some lines on the right side of the original line and also on the left side of the original line. This original line is known as unmodified line because its frequency remains the same. So in the scattered light, Raman observed some lines having same frequency as that of the incident light and some lines having more frequency, nu plus delta nu, than the incident light and some lines having frequency less than the frequency of the incident light. So Raman named all these lines whose frequency is greater than the incident light as anti-Stokes lines and those lines whose frequency is less than the incident light frequency are named as Stokes lines. These anti-Stokes lines and Stokes lines are symmetrically placed on both sides of the unmodified line. This delta nu is called Raman shift. Now let us study the characteristics. This Raman shift is independent of the frequency of the incident light. How he drew this conclusion? He took same substance in the Raman tube. He used once mercury light, another time some other light, another time some other lamp. So when the lamps are changed, the delta nu will not change. So he concluded that the Raman shift does not depend on the frequency of the incident light. If you use mercury light or any laser light or cadmium source of light or sodium source of light, delta nu remains the same, which tells that this Raman shift does not depend on the frequency of the incident light. Next, he repeated the experiment having same lamp, but now in the Raman tube, he went on changing the substance. First, one kind of substance, next, another substance, next, another substance. So, whenever substance was changed, he observed the delta nu value was changing. So, he concluded that Raman shift is independent of the frequency of the incident light, but it is characteristics of the substance taken in the Raman tube. Raman shift does not depend on the frequency of the incident light, but the frequency of the Raman lines depend on the frequency of the incident light. For example, anti-Stokes lines have frequency greater than the frequency, that means nu plus del nu. So frequency of Raman lines depend on the frequency of the incident light, but the Raman shift did not depend on the frequency of the incident light. Then the lines with the greater frequency are known as anti-Stokes lines, and the lines whose frequency was lesser than the frequency of the incident light are known as Stokes lines. Again, using analyzer and polarizer, he studied the Raman lines. He found that Raman lines are strongly polarized and symmetrically placed about the incident light. And Raman effect is purely molecular phenomena. The substance is made up of molecules. Every molecule is made up of atoms. So Raman effect is purely a molecular phenomena. Raman effect does not depend on the atomic, that means how the electron is getting excited and it is going back. No, how the molecules are getting disturbed due to the incidence of the light. So Raman effect is purely molecular phenomena. This simple diagram helps us to understand the Raman spectrum very effectively. Suppose if the molecule is in the lower level energy, let me say it is a ground state. This molecule absorbs energy from the incident photon and gets excited. It cannot stay in the excited state for a longer time. In 10 power minus 8 seconds, it should return back. When it is returning back, it does not come to the ground state. It goes to the next excited level. So, a molecule, to remain in the excited level, it needs some energy. That some energy is taken from the incident light photon. As a result, the light photon gets scattered with less energy. So, the energy of the scattered photon becomes lesser. So, energy of the scattered photon becomes lesser means those lines are known as Stokes lines. I hope you can understand. When the molecule in the ground state getting excited to the excited level and returns back to another excited level and not to the ground state, means the molecule is still having some energy to remain in the excited state. This energy has come from the incident photon. As a result, incident photon loses its energy and getting scattered with a frequency lesser than the frequency of the incident photon. Now look at the second diagram. The molecule from the ground state getting excited, and after 10 power minus 8 seconds, it returns back to the ground state. That means what energy was absorbed by the molecule was given out. As a result, the light photon getting scattered with the same energy as that of the incident energy. So the light photon getting scattered, energy did not change, frequency did not change. So this type of scattering is called Rayleigh scattering. And we come to the third diagram. The molecule is in the excited state. Now light is falling on this molecule in the excited state. Already it has some excess energy. Now, additional energy is given to that. As a result, molecule is pushed to the excited state. And now, It comes to the ground state by giving its excess energy to the photon. So now photon absorbs this excess energy and getting scattered with more energy, or the frequency of the scattered photon will be greater than the incident frequency. And these lights are known as anti-Stokes lights. Now, by studying this Raman effect, we can understand how the molecule is made up of, how many atoms are involved, how the atoms are bonded. When the light photon gives energy, how the atoms in the molecule getting stretched or getting bent or getting some rotations, all these properties could be studied if we study the Raman effect of the scattered light. So the light is allowed to fall on the molecular substance. The molecular substance respond and interact with the incident light energy. As a result, the vibrational levels or the rotational levels of the atoms in the molecule getting affected. So their pattern, vibrating pattern or the rotating pattern changes. So by studying all these changes, you can tell the atoms are whether symmetrically placed about the mid atom or rotational or vibration. All this can be studied. Now let us see the quantum theory of Raman effect. The light is falling on the substance. Now before the interaction and after the interaction, how the system is present, that is what we are going to see. Let us say that Raman effect is due to the interaction between the light photon and the molecule of the scatterer. Suppose a photon of frequency mu 1 is incident on the molecule and there is a collision between them. Let m be the mass of the molecule and v1 and v2 are the velocities of the molecule before the interaction and after the interaction of the photon. Let us say E1 and E2 are the intrinsic energies of the molecule before and after the interaction of the photon. You will get doubt, what is this intrinsic energy? Some energy is needed to keep the atoms inside the molecule. That energy is called intrinsic energy. So before light photon incident on the molecule, let E1 be the intrinsic energy. After the interaction, the intrinsic energy of the molecule may be increased or may be decreased. Let that be E2. And let nu1 and nu2 are the frequencies of the photon before interaction and after interaction with the molecule. Now let us apply the principle of conservation energy before interaction and after interaction. You see now, before interaction the intrinsic energy was E1 and the kinetic energy of the molecule was half mv1 squared and the photon had energy hv1. After the interaction, the light photon has interacted with the molecule of the substance. As a result, the intrinsic energy changes from E1 to E2, kinetic energy to half mv2 squared and the photon energy becomes hv2. Here, photon can donate energy to the molecule or molecule can donate energy to the photon. But the total energy should be conserved. To simplify further, we say that the light photon when it incident on the molecule of the substance, the kinetic energy may not be much affected. So under this assumption, let us ignore the kinetic energy before and after the interaction. So the expression reduces to E1 plus hv1. Which is equal to E2 plus hv2. Now you rearrange, you are able to get E1 minus E2 equal to hv2 minus mu1. The difference in frequency, we refer it as changing frequency, delta nu. So delta nu equal to E1 minus E2 by h. So nu2 equal to nu1 plus E1 minus E2 by h. There are three cases. E1 equal to E2. In this case, this term becomes 0, then nu2 becomes mu1. This is what called unmodified line in the Raman spectrum. Next, let us consider E2, intrinsic energy after the interaction with the photon has increased. E2 is greater than E1. E2 is negative. So what happens? This is more. So this term becomes lesser. Okay? Minus. So from nu 1, it is getting subtracted. So what happens? Nu 2 becomes lesser than nu 1. When the frequency is reduced after the interaction, we call these lines to be Stokes lines. That means molecule has absorbed some energy from the incident photon. As a result, the photon getting scattered with less energy and less frequency. You can say less frequency or larger wavelength. Okay, frequency less means wavelength will be larger. So this is what called Stokes lines. The third case is that E2 is lesser than E1, or you can say E1 is greater than E2. That means before the interaction, intrinsic energy was higher. After the interaction, the intrinsic energy of the molecule is lesser. That means molecule has given some energy to the incident photon. As a result, photon getting scattered with more energy or more frequency. Okay, so this is what represented as anti-Stokes lines. By Planck's law, so a molecule can absorb or emit energy in terms of quant of energy only. Let us say that the change in intrinsic energy of the molecule, that means molecule can absorb energy from the light photon or give energy to the light photon with this value nh nu m, where nu m is the characteristic frequency of the substance. Okay, n equal to 1, 2, 3, etc. In general, let us say the incident light has frequency nu. When n equal to 1, the anti-Stokes lines will have more frequency. This we say nu plus nu m. And frequency of Stokes line is nu s equal to nu minus nu m. Raman spectroscopy is used to analyze a wide range of materials, including gases, liquids, and solids. So when you want to put a liquid or solid or gas into certain applications, you are expected to study the Raman spectra. Next one, complex materials such as biological organisms and human tissue can also be analyzed to detect diseases such as cancer. The third application is that Raman spectroscopy gives detailed information about molecular structure. It can be used to examine the rotational and vibrational states of the atoms in the molecule and number of atoms and what is the strength of the bond, and to identify the chemical bonds, whether single bond or double bond or triple bond, everything could be studied with the help of Raman spectroscopy. Thus, Raman effect plays a significant role in chemical sensing, that means how the molecule is made up of, and biological imaging. By taking the tissue and studying, you can find out the diseases attack the tissue and the material characterization. Thus, Raman spectroscopy is a very powerful tool in the field of research in material engineering. Now, whether we have understood Raman effect or not can be tested by solving the problem. So here I have chosen one problem. The exciting line in an experiment is having 5460 Armstrong unit. Armstrong unit is the unit of wavelength. Now you are given a clue word, exciting line. When light photon incident over the substance, the molecules get excited. So which is exciting the molecules to higher energy levels? the incident light. So the incident light, the other name is called exciting light, and its wavelength. So incident light wavelength is 546 angstrom unit, and you are getting a Raman line at 5520 angstrom unit. Now the author did not give whether it is anti-Stokes line or Stokes line. From the data, you are expected to realize whether it is anti-Stokes line or Stokes line. We know anti-Stokes lines will have higher frequency or lesser wavelength, or Stokes lines will have lesser frequency and higher wavelength. Now you compare the wavelength with the incident wavelength. So we find that the wavelength of the Raman line is higher than the incident wavelength. Clearly it tells it is the wavelength of the Stokes line. So you find out what is the difference between the Stokes line and the incident line. That is delta lambda. You know, anti-Stokes lines will have lesser wavelength. So from the incident wavelength, you subtract this delta lambda, this Raman shift, you will be getting a wavelength which is called the wavelength of the anti-Stokes line. Once again, let us confirm, wavelength of the anti-Stokes line will be lesser than the incident light. Wavelength of the Stokes line will be higher than the incident wavelength. By understanding this, simply by identifying whether you are getting Stokes line or anti-Stokes line, you can determine what is Raman shift. And using this Raman shift, you can find out whether anti-Stokes line or Stokes line, wavelength or frequency. So I hope by this, you will able to understand the concept of Raman effect, and you will be able to solve some problems also. So thank you, one and all.